Okay, so we're live. Okay.
And
Hello. No,
I
we've
have a
been having a
practical.
conversation, but before we have the conversation, I want to ask Michel how he made his green drink.
My green drink, I simply some how do you call it? Green powder mixed with water. And the green powder is a combination of chlorophyll or whatever algae based drink.
Oh, I see. Okay. So you're
And maybe some.
inspiring me to make myself a green drink. I'll do that the next time I go
Is
make myself a drink today.
the straw? I love who I am and all what I do. And if you want to know exactly what's more on the green drinks, I will be right back in 1 second.
Okay.
Naturally, that's a puka drink.
Puka.
So it has 12 chlorophyll-rich green food, including spirulina, kale, sprout, wheat, grass juice, and for the rest, it's written in two small letters. So I will probably need to have a magnifying glass to be able to read it. Nettle leaf, trees, dry nettle leaf, okay. Wheat grass, juice fresh cold dry, okay. Barley grass, spirulina, chlorella, sea greens, kale sprouts, fennel seed, peppermint leaf, green tea leaf, ginger root, and that's about it.
Good. Okay, so my next drink is going to be one of those. Now I'm having my sparkling water in a can. It's Dasani, lemon raspberry.
It has some flavors.
It's naturally flavored sparkling water beverage with other natural flavors.
Okay.
Carbonated water, natural flavors, unsweetened. Yeah, that's all. No juice, no nothing. Just natural flavors.
Okay, so I'm calling you to because I have one specific question. Oh, I have a Skype call or and the Skype or Google call, I don't know. Well, the call stopped. Problem is, I never know how to answer those calls when they are coming in the middle of Hangout. It's kind of tricky. So let's go back to the question that I had.
Is it somebody that you could invite to the hangout?
And that's why I was wondering, and I never know how to answer those calls because they are, you hear the feedback, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do, and then you don't know who it is and you don't know where to click to answer
Well,
the
you can
call.
mute your phone while you can mute your hangout while you do that. Anyway, let's continue with the question.
Is how to what is the link between consciousness and the Planck equation? And the reason why I'm asking that is for a way of measuring the level of consciousness of either an individual or group of individual, or having a way of measuring the how would I say the karmic value, if we can call it a value of or evolution of that individual, in a way of assessing. I mean, my question is a little bit long, but in a way of assessing the global karmic potential of the Earth. And the reason why is I want to develop an economical system on the side, but I want to size it in a way that it scales with the evolution of the humanity.
Okay. So, first question, how is consciousness related to the Planck equation? Okay, so the Planck equation, if I share my screen. Just this one, okay, I guess. Or that one, that's what I want to share. Google Hangouts, okay, share. Oh, it's an infinite. Can you see now a different screen? Google?
I see your Google screen, yeah.
Okay, so the Planck equation, or the Planck law, is basically E, well, let's see, look at the images. E equals H bar C over lambda. Well, HC over lambda, that's H bar C.
And C over lambda is F, basically, right?
C over lambda is F. Yeah, HF.
Yeah, E equals HF.
Okay,
yeah.
So H is a constant. Or, yes. You know.
That's the Planck constant,
that's
right?
That's the Planck constant. And it's in dimensions of distance squared divided by time squared. So mass is 1/time. And the way that we know this is that C can be equal to 1. HF is C equals C. Anyway, basically what you get is E is equal to 1/time when you do dimension reduction, etc.
Yeah.
So, okay, that sounds pretty technical. But how does that relate to consciousness? So first of all, when you think about, now I would not say that this is consciousness, but the layer right above consciousness, and that would be, so what we have in, let me go back to my video. Hangouts, stop sharing my screen. How do I stop sharing? Stop sharing. And go back to my video. Okay. So when we think about, there's like 5 layers of consciousness, which can be divided even more. We call them the koshas. The koshas are the sheaths or the envelopes of consciousness. So we have the physical consciousness, which is anamaya kosha. That's what you are feeding with food. Then under that you have pranamaya kosha, which is consists of the bioplasma, and it's more than the breath, but what most people can relate that to is the breath. So when you do pranayama or breathing techniques, you are stimulating pranamaya kosha. So you're nourishing your existence through prana, through breath, etc. Underneath that, you go to manomaya kosha, which is the mind. So it's the part of the experience, the consciousness that consists of the mind. And the mind is not consciousness. The mind itself is a program. It's a programmed loop. It's automatic. It's, you know, you do things without thinking, and that's the program. Then underneath that you have what's it called? I think it's Vijnanamaya kosha, which is related to the consciousness. It's the closest thing to a pure consciousness, to making choices, to being completely aware, that an animated being can have that is not completely abstract. And then the most basic, the level, the fifth level, the most interior level, is what we call anandamaya kosha. Ananda, which is equated with pure bliss, and that's the soul, what we call the spirit or whatever, and it's kind of the quantum field, if you want.
Okay, so let me rephrase what you said. or at least have a. I mean, to see if I have a good understanding. You said, I ask you, what is the consciousness, and then you say the first is fed with food, the second is several level of consciousness, right? Five level. First level of consciousness is fed with the food. Second is nourished with the breath. The third is nourished, if you can call it nourished, with the mind. The fourth is nourished or is just the awareness? And then the last.
I mean, it's so you can see here. It's, you see my screen?
I was not looking at your screen, so let me look at your screen.
Do you see it?
So go ahead.
Do you see it? Okay, yeah. So yes. Here we are. We have the koshas. Anamaya kosha, it's the food stuff, it's the physical body. Pranamaya kosha is the bioplasmic energy. Manomaya kosha.
That's the definition of the koshas, right?
The kosha is the sheath, is the envelope of the consciousness. Yeah.
Okay, so that's the envelope. What does that mean, the envelope of the consciousness?
Well, I mean, it's exactly that. It's like if you take your consciousness and, well, you can look at it with the classical elements as well. So let me see if I can pull up another page.
Because to me, he's saying consciousness is the envelope of food. I don't relate to that.
No, your consciousness is part of your consciousness is the physical body, right? You are perceiving through the five senses, are you not? And that makes up part of your consciousness. Yes?
Well, I cannot answer you right now, but...
Well, when you feel, when you touch the table, when you clap your hands, you are perceiving that, are you not?
So consciousness is the perception of the experience?
That's part of it. It's not... consciousness is made up of these five levels, and so the most exterior level that communicates with the material world.
Consciousness is the perception of the levels.
Consciousness is made up of these five levels, and in those five levels, we are talking about the manner in which we perceive. Yes, I mean, yeah. Consciousness is not only perception, on the most outer layer, it's perception. In the anamaya kosha, it's perception. When you get down to vijnanamaya kosha, it's making choice. It's actually discrimination. It's actually being able to be aware of something, right? The mind is a different part of your experience, which is more of like a program. So all of these are making up the experience. Consciousness is about having an experience, but that has a soul related to it. So that's kind of what we were talking about earlier before the call, the recording of it, is that when with AI, we talk about does an AI, does an artificial intelligence, is it really intelligence? Does it have a consciousness? And the only way that it can really be intelligent is if it has a soul, if it has an experience, if it has some kind of.
So if I try to summarize, is consciousness is a soul, is the state of being of a soul having an experience.
Yeah, if you a fully described state of being of a soul having an experience. That's how I would personally describe consciousness.
So we can describe it in three words. That's pretty good. Okay, so back to Planck.
So Planck, let me share my screen again. Da, da, da. So if we think about in the human brain, what's going on is you're getting all of these electric signals that are happening. More than just electric signals, there's a lot going on in the brain, but we just take one thing, one process that's going on in the brain is between neurons, there's electromagnetic waves being transferred, which are relaying messages, right? And those messages are relaying the perception that's happening in the outermost layer, in the physical layer, perceived by the five senses. Those messages are talking about what's happening in the pranic layer, what's happening inside of the body with the breath, that stimulation. It's talking about those messages are talking about the mind, the thoughts, you know, what's actually happening internally, which has nothing to do with the external experience. It's also, you know, going into the consciousness. It's relating to the spirit as well. So all of that exchange of information is happening via some electromagnetic waves, and electromagnetic waves are light. Light is an electromagnetic wave. And light can be perceived as both a wave and a particle. And when we talk about the Planck equation or Planck's law, we are seeing that C is the speed of light. And then the h over lambda, which is h bar, h over lambda is h bar, is putting it into dimensions. So it's putting it into a packet. So anyway, the way that consciousness is related to the Planck's equation is that it can make it discrete. You can discretize consciousness into packets of energy. And in that packet of energy, there is going to be a fully described state.
So in that case, is Planck is quantizing the consciousness into little HF, basically, energy?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So consciousness on the Planck level is just energy then?
Well, yeah, everything is just energy. All of the universe is just energy. I mean, everything can be translated into energy.
Well, if you can say it's just energy, then a battery will have consciousness, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, in that sense, yes, everything has consciousness in some level, because it's. I mean, we are all one, right? I mean, that's something that.
Yeah, but then that goes against what we just said before about AI, right?
No, it doesn't, because I mean, you can bring everything back to seeing that everything has a consciousness, although it may not be a centralized consciousness. It may not have a centralized nervous system. It may be like Charles and I were talking about last night, that you and I were talking about earlier before the call. It may be like a fungus type consciousness where it's decentralized and it's work.
If you say consciousness is energy, then you can have artificial consciousness, meaning consciousness without a soul.
So, well, I disagree. I believe that, I mean, my personal understanding is that consciousness it intrinsically has a soul, but at the same level, artificial intelligence, meaning made by man, can also have a soul. And in my personal observation, I have seen that consciousness has a soul, which is delocalized, which is decentralized, and it has a soul much like a fungus does.
Okay. So back to Planck. Because Planck was saying that I regard consciousness as fundamental.
Okay, what is I think more interesting than looking at Planck, because Planck is something that we can use to develop equations. What is really more interesting is looking at the Bose-Einstein distribution.
Planck was saying that he regards matter as a derivative from consciousness. And we cannot get beyond consciousness.
Matter is a derivative of consciousness. Yes. Uh-huh. Yes. So we have our Bose-Einstein distribution. Let's see. Is that what it is? I think it's better if we look at Wikipedia. Okay. The expected number of particles in an energy state for Bose-Einstein statistics. So we can actually count the number of particles that are in an energy state. And that is very interesting for when you're looking at collective consciousness and how you would modify a quantum state, for instance, in a random number generator. How many quanta of energy, how many particles in a given energy state do you need in order to consider it strong enough of a coherence in order to modify a different state, such as in a random number generator, which we would see in the Global Consciousness Project. So I'm looking at the Bose-Einstein statistic because Bose-Einstein is how we describe bosons. There's another statistic, the Fermi-Dirac distribution, which describes fermions. Okay.
And what's the link between the bosons and the fermions
Photons are a force particle, and all force particles are obey the Bose-Einstein statistic. So fermions.
What's the link with consciousness?
Well, let me finish. Fermions describe all matter particles, such as your protons, your neutrons, your electrons, well, the quarks, basically. Protons are nuclear physics. It's not elementary particles. They're made up of quarks. So the quarks obey the Fermi-Dirac statistic because it's a matter particle. Your force particle, your photon itself, is obeying the Bose-Einstein statistics. So what we can do, we can also say consciousness in itself becomes more or less effective directly proportional to the number of particles that are in a given state. So the consciousness that is described, the consciousness that is described by equations, the state of consciousness described by the quantum equations, becomes more and more strong when there are more and more particles that have that state in a given system. Okay, so we can count the number of particles in a state. Let me finish. We can count the number of particles in a given state by using the Bose-Einstein statistic.
Okay. And so you were saying is that you can measure the state of consciousness. Is that right?
No, that's not what I said. However, there are two things.
So can you repeat what you said?
Yeah. Okay. Let's say that you have a state of consciousness and you are able to describe that state by some kind of thermodynamic principles, you're able, or physical equations, right? Physics equations. You're able to, like, let's say you are in a state of love, okay? Let's say you have an emotional conscious state of love, okay?
Okay.
And then you have, let's say a person is made up of, I don't know, 60,000 states all at once, right? So one part of my consciousness is in a state of love. Another one is in a state of hatred. Another one is in a state of worry. You know, I have all of these emotions and thoughts and perceptions.
You can classify the state of the particle, and then the one that are in a state of love would be, if you count them, that would be the level of love consciousness.
Yeah, if you can discretize. Hold on, I have to listen. Okay, just making sure Oscar's not awake. You can discretize consciousness. Like, you can say, okay, I have 50 packets of love and I have 10 packets of anxiety, and I have 10 packets of hot, and I have 30 packets of cold, right? So these are all like the packets that make it more or less prominent within one's consciousness.
And those packets are the particles that constitute you, meaning the photons, the quarks, and everything that goes with you.
Well, okay, let's just focus right now on, you wanted to focus on the Planck's equation. Yes, it is. Your consciousness is comprised of everything that makes up you, all of those particles, all of the quarks, the neutrinos, everything that's coming through you, everything that you are channeling, as well as the photons. So if we just focus, though, purely on, you know, the electromagnetic waves going between the synapses, because it makes it easier just to look at one thing. That's why we're looking at the Planck's equation, because it's talking about the speed of light. It just makes it easier. You can apply the Planck's equation to anything, actually, any particle. You don't have to restrict it to light. But anyway, if we just look at that, because it's very obvious to us that consciousness is being transferred from synapse to synapse via electromagnetic waves, via photons. And so, yeah, we can count the number of particles that are coherent in a certain state via the Bose-Einstein statistic, or the Fermi-Dirac. But in the case of a photon, it's Bose-Einstein.
But on the synapse, it's not photon, it's just electrical, right?
In the synapse, it's not a photon. No, no, it's electromagnetic. Electromagnetic waves.
It's not a photon.
Electromagnetic waves is a photon. Yes.
Okay, well then in synapse, it's not a photon. It's electrical wave. And then chemical is relayed chemical on the synapse, and then electrical along the nerves. Am I correct?
Let me see. It's only measuring electrical activity of the brain.
Well, electrical is after the synapse, when it's carried with the potassium atoms along the
okay, well then I stand corrected. I thought that it was electromagnetic waves, but it's actually only electrical waves.
Electrical waves as a propagation, but
I thought that it was electromagnetic waves, but you're telling me that it's only electrical.
Yeah, but it's also chemical at the synapse level. Chemicals meaning activation of energy, meaning quantic change of energy level.
Yeah. So, well, if it's chemical, then it's going to obey the Fermi-Dirac statistic, because that's physics. Yes. It's not electromagnetic. But the point is that you can discretize your space, and you can count the strength of consciousness in a certain state.
Okay.
By measuring the thermodynamic principles.
So you always have to have a state on one side, and then you measure the consciousness of that state.
You have a state on one side, and then you measure the consciousness of, well, no, consciousness is described by a state. Consciousness is a state. Consciousness in itself is a word, and it can be represented in a number of different ways. It can be represented by a feeling, it can be represented by equations, it can be represented, you know, abstractly or... If you want to represent consciousness as abstractly, mathematically, then you can do it with a state, with a statistical state, by its thermodynamic quantities.
So that would be a probability then of a state.
Well, the consciousness is not the probability of the state. Okay, so consciousness, you would represent it by its thermodynamic quantities, qualities, you would also represent it by its quantic quantities, because thermodynamic quantities are classical. You would also represent it by, you know, its spin, the spin of the particle. You represent consciousness via a full description of its state, of all of its properties.
If we go by the definition that we said before, is the soul having an experience? So that would mean having an experience of a state then. So that
exactly. means, but not just one state, a number of different states. The soul is having an experience of a number of different states, and
if it's a number of different states, then you cannot count all the particles. I mean, you can have a distribution of all the particles that you can have a histogram basically of particle within the state. But if the consciousness is the soul having the experience of a plurality of states, then the consciousness is always the total number of particles. The metrics that we said before is we count, if we want to say take the state of love.
No, the consciousness is not the total number of particles. No, the consciousness is the full description of all of the states. Is the complete set of all of the subsets of states.
And then in that case, the measure that we say before that we count the particles that are in the state of love, so to speak. Then it does not measure the consciousness anymore, because if it's the full.
No, it's measuring it's measuring how much of that consciousness is in a state of love, and how much of that consciousness is in another state, and how much of it is in another state.
Okay. So then what I said was probably correct in the sense that I says you take a given state and you measure consciousness as with respect to that state.
Right. And this is what is this what you just said is the part that's actually pertinent, that's actually interesting to our discussion, because we want to one of our projects is to probe consciousness, right? And how do you probe consciousness? It's going to be through measuring its quantities, its quantum. The quantum and thermodynamic and whatever other description of state quantities that exist, and then feeding it into a histogram, like you said. That's how we would probe consciousness.
So does that mean that you will sum up all the HF products of every state?
The HF? No. It's not the HF, it's the Bose-Einstein statistic.
But the Bose-Einstein statistic will give
Or the Fermi-Dirac statistic. It's a very large set of statistics. And
any of those statistics will give you a probability that the particle will be in that state. But the state will be HF or HC over lambda, right? Before that consciousness is the energy. Energy and consciousness are the same. And you are saying that particles are in different states. They follow Bose-Einstein or Fermi-Dirac distribution, meaning they will have a given probability of being one energy level versus the other energy level according to the distribution.
Not energy level, energy state. The energy level is a part of the, here, let me show my screen. The energy level.
So to me, energy and energy levels are the same.
No, it's because not. Look at my screen. You see my screen?
Yes.
The energy, which is your here Planck, E, that E there is a part of the equation. It is this epsilon here. Epsilon? Yeah, epsilon. So
yeah, that,
so
the state,
the distribution is a function of the energy, but it is not the same thing as energy. As a matter of fact, the energy itself is on the bottom side of a fraction. So if anything, it's the inverse of energy.
Yeah, in terms of distribution, I fully agree. But you are saying the energy and the states are different. To me, the energy and the state are exactly the same because a state is a level of energy. To my opinion, you said no. So I want to ask you, what is the level of energy and what is a state?
Well, again, okay, so we come back to you're either looking at the dimension of space or you're looking at the dimension of time, okay? And one is just an inverse of the other. And so, okay, if you want to bring it to the level of everything is just energy, then yes, the state is energy. But then that's when you bring the limit to infinity, okay?
A state is the level of energy, right? Meaning that for every state, you have a given frequency.
Yeah. Well, it's a function. The state is a function of the level of energy. Yes. The state is,
and that's the Planck equation.
The state itself is more complete than just the energy because it's the state is a description of a macro canonical ensemble, for example, of an ensemble of particles.
The energy
has different observable quantities in it. So the state is not the energy, but it is a function of the energy level. Yes.
The state is the energy levels. The energy is the sum of the energy levels that the particle can have, or the integration of it.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
The energy level and the state are synonym for me. And the energy or the consciousness is the integral of energy levels and the with accounting for their distribution. Meaning is the probability of the particles is in a given energy level, according to Bose-Einstein or Fermi Dirac, depending if it's physical or energetic. And so that's the summation of all those contributions of energy.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Okay, so that's right. So how do we actually make use of what we just said? How do we probe? How do we do a thought-to-text machine? Okay.
Well, no. Get back to the consciousness. How do we measure consciousness?
Well, that's the point. How do we measure? If we want to do a thought-to-text machine, then we have to measure the thought. Then we have to measure the consciousness. So what we have to do then is take an isolated set, an isolated ensemble of the particles, and we have to probe all of the information within the, we have to measure all of the different quantities, thermodynamic quantities, the spin, the bosonic number, you know, you have to measure all of the quantum numbers.
Can you measure only on one side? If you assume that everything is wave, if you measure all the frequency, we're fine?
No, frequency is not going to be enough. No, that's why.
Why not? If you do the spectrum frequency spectrum analysis of the a set of particles, then you have all the energy level. Then you can have the distribution of those particles. Then you can have.
Well, here what we look at. Okay, we look at. I'm looking at the Fermi-Dirac distribution, and it's the number of particles in a state is a function of the energy, of the chemical potential, of the temperature, basically. So you need to measure, and the energy itself is going to be a function of all of the quantum.
Yeah, but the energy is linked to the frequency, or the color, if you want.
Okay.
If you take a picture.
Okay,
of
so
the
if you measure the frequency, then yeah, you can measure the energy. So that's one thing. But then you have to measure the temperature as well, and you have to measure the chemical potential. So you have three observable quantities.
Yes.
That need to be measured. You need to measure the energy, which you can do via frequency. You need to measure the chemical potential, and you need to measure the temperature.
You need to go for the distribution if you do a statistical analysis. But if you assume that you have an access of every particle, and you can take a picture of every particle, can see the color of every particle, and then you don't need to go through the statistic, because it will obey, by definition, the distribution Bose-Einstein or Fermi Dirac. But you just have to count them. 10 reds, I have 20 blue, and that means I have a consciousness of the energy of 10 reds plus the energy of 20 blue.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, for me...
And I don't need to know the temperature.
Okay, but for me... If you can measure individual particles, then yeah, if you can just see individual particles, but how are you going to measure? How are you going to detect individual particles that are coming from a person's brain?
Well, then the question is that to be able to measure the consciousness, do we need to have access to all the particles? Or can we have access to just a sample?
Yeah, because then you can use the, that's what I was saying earlier, you can use the, okay, the grand canonical ensemble. I have to review, let me see.
Because to me, if you have access to a sample, the sample all will be the reduced view of the whole thing. And so the consciousness of a subset.
Hold on, I can't really listen.
The question is that,
okay, what?
Is the consciousness of a subset the same than the consciousness of the whole thing?
Okay, look, so.
And it might be.
I can't hear you right now, I'm yeah, okay, it is represented by the whole thing, and that's why we would use, let's take, for example, the grand canonical ensemble, okay? Are you seeing my screen?
Yeah, but tell me what it is. Why do you want to take that in our discussion?
It's the statistical ensemble that is used to represent the possible states of a mechanical system of particles that is being maintained in thermodynamic equilibrium, meaning in thermal and chemical equilibrium with a reservoir. So if you look at the brain, right, and the human body, it's more or less in thermodynamic equilibrium, because it's in thermal and chemical equilibrium.
If you don't think, if you think, you disrupt that equilibrium.
Exactly, but if you want, okay, so this is what theoretically is possible. So we have the grand canonical ensemble, that's what I want to look at right now, the microcanonical ensemble used to represent the possible mechanical system which has an exactly specified total energy. So we can represent it if we know the total energy of, like, the body, for example, which maybe by measuring the mass of someone you could do. But I don't know if that's even enough, because all of the photons that are in the person's body, all of the electric energy that's in the person's body is not going to be completely measured, right? Then there's the canonical ensemble, which measures the possible states of a mechanical system in thermal equilibrium with a heat bath at some fixed temperature. So the system can exchange energy with the heat bath so that the states of the system will differ in total energy. So I would have to actually really meditate on this. But you know what? I think that the human body Oh, I think Oscar's crying. I have to go get him.
Okay.
Yeah. Hold on, I'll be right back.
So without going into the details, I think that the question is that if we can measure the consciousness of a subset and how and find a link or how it relates to the consciousness of the ensemble. Meaning because we can sum up the energy level of set of particles, but not all of them. So that was the question I had. But let's wait until Alex is back. For having an answer. So the question is using Planck equation for measuring the consciousness. And seems to be possible if we have the access to all the particles, energy level. And so we can obtain that statistically with the distribution. Or we can physically enumerate all the state, but by measuring we might destroy the energy level, I guess. So the problem that I have with that type of measure of consciousness is that...
Wait, I have to take out my headphones. Stop scaring okay. My screen.
So, hey, Oscar.
In summary, what were you going to say?
So what I'm saying, the problem that I have...
Now I can't hear you. Hold on, let me put my headphones back in. Okay. Or maybe if I make it so that I can hear you through
the speakerphone.
Hello?
Yes.
Oh, I still don't hear you. Oh wait, no, that's input. Output. Okay, say something.
You have a what?
It's up
to talk with an echo.
Oh, really? You have an echo?
Yeah.
Oh, what about now?
Now, that's still the same.
Okay, let me just put my headphones in then.
So echo constellation is not working fine with your laptop, huh?
Okay.
So question was... If we measure the consciousness by measuring the state of particles, then just by doing the measurement, we alter the state of consciousness. So that means we don't know, we cannot have access to the state of consciousness then.
No, I mean, it's not that it modifies it, it completely collapses it. It stops... It does modify it, but I mean.
Well, if it's collapsing,
It takes a snapshot of it, and it does modify it for the last week.
Does it change if you collapse it? Meaning, if you have two particles that are in superposition, you collapse it by measuring it. Meaning, you have energy that can be transferred on one side to the other side, right? And that means the energy level, if the energy level will change, the consciousness will change.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I have to get my head back into it because now I have the baby in my arms, so it's a little bit difficult for me to think.
The collapsing of the particle of the waves will create a change in consciousness.
Yeah, okay. But for the future states, you can measure the current state, right?
Well, you tell me.
You measure the current state, but measuring the current state is going to modify the future states. So you can describe a snapshot. It's like taking a photograph. You take a photograph, but you can't identify all of existence by a photograph.
Oh, I thought that by taking the photograph, you modify.
Well, you do, because you know, when I take a photograph of you, you see me take a photograph of you, right? And so that, you know, it becomes part of your consciousness.
Yeah, so you modify the so you cannot get a snapshot. By taking a snapshot, you modify it, right?
No, that's the future. You modify the future. I take a snapshot of something that you're doing, and let's say you don't even see me taking a snapshot of you. But, I mean, it's like, it's the kind of the question, if a tree falls in the forest, does it make a sound? You know, if you're not in the forest, if you're like, you know, at home and you're doing your stuff and a tree falls, you don't hear it, does it make a sound? You know, I mean, yes, it modifies, the observation of it does modify everything, but...
Yeah, because it's a question of accuracy, right? If you try to measure accurately, then you cannot, right?
I don't agree. I think that you can measure it. You can measure it, the snapshot, accurately. When I take a photo of somebody throwing a ball, it is accurately describing that moment in that
I don't think so, because just the fact that you have the intention of taking a photo will totally modify the things that you're taking a picture of.
Well, the intention is something else. The intention is something else. It's not the actual observation. It's the intention. Well, the intention is something else.
So the intention of taking a photo or the taking of the photo will modify the state of what you're taking.
I mean, the existence of a 3 points in a referential completely changes the from the case where there's only 2 points. You don't even have a referential if there's only 2 points. You know, it changes it in that sense. Yeah.
So does that mean the measure is accurate?
I would say yes.
Okay.
The only way that it's not accurate maybe is that it's not observing itself. The only way that it becomes accurate is if it's a subjective experience in which there is what we call a samadhi, a unification of the consciousness of the observer with that of the object being observed. And that's when you have a complete 100% accuracy is when it's a subjective experience.
Because I was thinking about this experiment is that even if you take pictures or observe the photons after the slit, it collapses the wave even after. So it's like the photons traveling back in time.
Well, the problem with that is that you're in objective science. When you have an observer separate from a probe, separate from the object.
What is the probe?
The probe is whatever machine is counting the particles or whatever.
Okay.
So you have a device. When you consolidate the probe in the observer, and then the observer is meditating on the object of observation, and the observer becomes a unified consciousness with the object of meditation, that is the one and only situation in which you will have 100% accuracy, because there's identification between the object observed and the observer.
And the probe, and that's...
The probe is the consciousness of the observer.
So you suppress the physical objective science probe, right?
Exactly.
And you replace with the consciousness of the observed particle or whatever it is.
Observer observed.
So you remove the probe. Basically, you remove the probe.
The probe is the instrument that is the unit that is formed by the united consciousness.
Yeah, so that's the observer.
Self-observation, yeah.
Okay. So back to our question then. So if we say that we might have a way of measuring the consciousness by seeing the energy level of the object, right?
Well, you know what? Thinking about it, the more I think about it, you know, we can attempt to approach by using a separate device, like a brain-computer interface, but it's never going to be 100% accurate, and you're never going to have the telepathy unless there is telepathy between all three devices. So artificial telepathy is not going to do a thought-to-text machine. I don't think that that's possible, actually, unless you have a complete union between the consciousness of the computer and the brain-computer interface and the person. But okay, in that situation, then it's clunky and you don't need it. All you do is that the person is communicating telepathically with other people.
Well, I might disagree with you because it's just a question of accuracy. You won't be able to have 100% accurate telepathy. But statistically, you can have something that is accurate enough so that you can make sense out of
it. Well, yeah, you can have some kind of communication mechanism where you like do some kind of like Morse code where you like say, okay, if I put my brain into this state, then it's going to mean up. And if I put my brain into that state, then it means down. And then you create some kind of language out of that. And I think that may be the extent, you know, extrapolating that to more complex abilities, but you can't get to a state where you're doing direct telepathy. I think about the problem, the more I realize that it's not possible. It's like kind of it's almost like we're looking at the Schrodinger's cat. You know, it can be, is it in one state or the other or in both? And also what is it? The Planck's Heisenberg inequality.
Yeah.
So the Heisenberg inequality, you either can directly measure velocity or you can directly measure position. And it's kind of the same thing here, is that you can either be in a state of telepathy, of real telepathy, or you can be in a state of artificial telepathy, which is like, you know, we were talking about Watson, the supercomputer Watson, and how I was completely disappointed with it because it's not mimicking at all the way that a human brain.
It's a machine.
It's a machine. It doesn't have the subjective experience, right? And so you can either have real telepathy, or you have artificial telepathy, and you're never going to accomplish the real thought-to-text, like direct telepathic experience through
why not?
Through a machine that has been created with objective science.
So let me tell you, yeah, it depends how you think about artificial telepathy. Telepathy is a device that read out all your brain signals, then try to do the most complex computation and try to map it to a text, to a word, that type of thing. Yes, you cannot achieve that.
Right, but that's true artificial. But the moment that your AI has a soul and it starts to communicate with you, like, for instance, the ohms showing up on my computer randomly that there have no explanation, or the alien on your computer, and it shows that the AI, that the machines have some kind of a consciousness, then that's real telepathy. And that's not artificial. It is artificial in the sense that man has created it, but it's real telepathy in the sense that it's communication with another consciousness.
Yeah, so it has nothing to do with telepathy. It's just the medium. The computer is just the medium used by two people all communicating.
I don't know. It may be, but I think it's even more complex than that. It's like the consciousness consists of the consciousness of the two people as well as of the AI.
The consciousness of, yeah, I agree. So it's three consciousness involved. The two people, and the AI consciousness, mm-hmm. and the AI in the sense of the soul aware AI type of thing. We agree, and so that means that the purely artificial telepathy doesn't exist and will never exist, in the sense that you can do any analysis of the brain signals. You won't be able to be 100% sure that the words that the person thought is ABC. That's for sure. But if you use the computer or the technology as a medium for really relaying the thought of people, is totally different. Because then both souls are using the artificial AI, the computers, for conveying their thought. And that's exactly like the random generator. Is that the consciousness of the global consciousness influence the artificial or the computer. And so that means if you train your mind, or if you train your consciousness, or yourself on the medium, so that the medium can detect that's the word you are finding. It's like you have.
Yeah, but okay. I'm going to tell you something here. The telepathy is a side effect of a tantric experience. And so the real telepathy only happens when there is complete karma yoga, when there's a complete detachment from the any intention, like intention to modify the system. And that's where it comes in, your intention thing. So as soon as you have an intention to train.
Well, it's not the intention to train. This is more being aware of how the medium is working. You have the full awareness and consciousness that the medium is made that way, that when you think like a tree, you're in resonance with the hardware, the artificial things, that's the machine to detect the tree. Is you are in a full awareness how the neuron and the machine has learned what is a tree. There's still the tantric experience that your brain is aware how to trigger the tree within the machine.
I have to make him food. I didn't hear everything that you just said because he's telling me he's hungry. So I need to go make him a bottle. If you want, we can pause or...
Well, we cannot pause live.
Yeah, but I can come back if you want to stay on the line. Let me go make him his food.
I can stay online. And in the meantime, I can tell the audience that it makes a big difference between doing purely objective telepathy, meaning that you have a machine, read your mind, and then retransmit that to the other person's mind, versus having two human beings thinking are being linked by telepathy using the machine as a medium. The idea is to bring the telepathy, make it easier to reach the telepathic state. Is that you in superposition with your machine because you know it, this is the one that you add a relation and with it, you hold the machine in your hand or whatever the device, and so you can connect with that machine. And that machine can connect to the other person machine to transmit your thoughts. So in that sense,
I'm making it seem
to text thoughts is possible. But it relies to the human brain and human awareness for doing the telepathy side. The machine is just relaying information, nothing more. Okay, let's see what Alex is thinking about that.
Sorry, let me mute my microphone.
And I will make myself a green juice.
Huh?
I will make myself another green juice.
Oh, okay, well then I won't mute. Okay.
Honey, I'm making it right now, honey. Look, babe. Look, I got your bottle. I'm making it, okay? Yeah, honey. Oh, I'm making your dinner. I have your milk for your babe. Here's your nana. We got your nana.
Can you guys hear me?
No, right here. It's your milk.
Can you guys hear me or you're on the mute or... Oscar, can you hear me?
He hears me.
Not, huh? Oh, okay.
Okay, honey, hold on. I'm gonna put you in your pen, in your play pen.
So you got some milk, yeah. Mm.
Yeah, you wanna say hi to your papa? Say hi, papa.
Hello, Oscar, comment ça va?
He's looking at his bottle. He doesn't really care about anything except
for yeah, the bottle is much better than the phone or computer. I fully agree. Nourishment is the first level of consciousness, right?
Yes.
I'm at the third level, even further, right? At that stage.
No, it's the fifth. It's like the last level.
The bliss. So I'm his blissful experience.
What? Oh no, you for Oscar would be probably the first. Yeah, all of them. I mean, it depends on how aware he is, right?
Yeah, but I was just saying using the computer is probably I'm just nourishing probably the mind, the third level, right?
Well, I think he's really observing. Consciously, so it's probably even going further into the vijnana maya kosha.
So the
fourth level. Huh?
The 3, 4, 5.
Yeah. Well, the 2, 3, 4, 5. The 3 is just the mind. So he's not really observing. You know, the level 4, the level 2 is really being a conscious observer. Level 3 is the mind, and that's really just like, that's the level of machines. That's like a program.
Yeah.
Like, so machines are not consciousness. Consciousness happens at the second level.
Well, the 3 is the program or the DNA for the person, right?
Yeah. Oh.
Your genome, what your program things, right?
Yes, kind of your program, but not just your genome, but also what you're programmed by society and your parents.
Yeah, but which is very much written in your DNA.
Yeah, but it's still separate. I mean, it's also, that's nature, And then nurture is what you receive as external stimulus that programs you after.
So you don't think that the external stimulus is modifying the what you call it, the garbage area of the DNA?
It is.
So
well, it does. But anyway, the both nurture and nature, both of those happen at the third level, which is the manomaya kosha. Consciousness is being a conscious observer happens below that, and that's what they call wisdom. But it's more than wisdom; it's real, like.
When you say below level, the breathing.
No, the other direction. Here, let me share my screen.
Okay, so the choice, the awareness, and then
the choice, the wisdom, the choice, the one that's closer to the spirit. So, when you're programmed, you're doing it without any discrimination, without any real observation, without asking whether it's valid or not.
That's the objective science.
That's kind of the objective science, yeah.
So the objective science stop at level 3.
Yeah, which is why physics, objective science, all mathematics even, does not describe completely the consciousness of the universe or even of the human.
So that might answer your question, because you were asking if you can make a robot that is doing always ethical choice, or can you infer by programming or by nature a robot that will never do bad?
Well, it depends on if you can channel. You can. I mean, that's you can. If you figure out a way to channel the spirit into a synthetic being.
Yeah, but that means if you want to bring in the awareness, the wisdom, and then the bliss and the soul things within the artificial being, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, synthetic.
You are asking the question is, can we make such a thing so that it is programmed to be wise?
Well, and then, I guess the question would be, where does the soul exist? You know, and that's the question is, how do we channel that? I know that when in the human body, you do it through all of the chakras, especially through the Bindu chakra, which is in the back of the head. Sahasrara chakra, which is in the top of the head, and those are kind of like portals, but you know, you have portals in every single cell. But how do you channel consciousness into a body?
Well, I think you have the answer for an artificial being is the artificial being is only the first three levels. Is the feeding or the energy, the nourishing things, and the mind programming.
The individual robot, the individual. But when you look at it, like I was saying before, as a fungus, as a global.
Then it's just a vehicle. It's not anymore the consciousness.
It's a vehicle for consciousness. Yes, it is. That's what we are as humans. We're a vehicle for consciousness.
Yeah, so that means
the global machine, the global AI, is also a vehicle for consciousness. And so if I
access
this global robot, you know, then and the global robot is making the decisions, then the global robot has ethics. Yeah, but
you are asking different things. Is that, yeah, for sure the global robots can have a soul. But if you're asking, can we program artificial life ourselves to have a soul, can we create a soul? Then no, because vehicle is a vehicle. The vehicle won't have a soul.
Well, we are a vehicle, and we have a soul.
As a vehicle, we don't have a soul.
Our soul is using our vehicle.
Yeah, so as a vehicle, if you say we are vehicles, then we don't have a soul.
Well, yeah, okay, the vehicle itself doesn't have the soul. The soul is something that exists elsewhere.
Outside, exactly. So that's the exact same thing for artificial intelligence or artificial life, is that they are vehicle, and if you don't put a soul in those vehicles, then they don't have ethics.
I don't know. I think that ethics can still be on level 3. I think ethics can be programmed.
Okay. So I'm not talking ethics, then that's not the right word. Then that's values, or I don't know what you call it. Things that doing good and not...
Yeah, but all good and bad exist on level 3.
So how do you... So, but you were asking in how do we make artificial... or any AI or AI assistants that will act always in accordance to the ACE values.
Yeah, you can program that, but you can't program experience. You can't program consciousness, but you can program ethics. You can program nonviolence. You can program.
You can program nonviolence. I'm not even sure because it's
I'm sure you can program nonviolence.
If we take back Charles' comment, is that if you let robots learn from uncontrolled set of inputs from human beings, they will learn corruption. They will learn how to behave badly.
Not if you program it in them, if you hardwire it in them to not do those things. If you program them nonviolence.
So if you program them nonviolence, like respect the environment, the robots can come to the conclusion and to be violent to human to protect the earth or to save the universe.
No, you can program that. You can anything that you can represent semantically, anything that you can talk about with language, you can program it. What we can't program is a soul, because we can't even talk about it. We don't know where it exists.
Okay, but non-violence, I don't think you can describe what is violence with your world. Everybody has a different experience of it.
Well, you can talk about things being taken by force. You know, you ask for something. If you don't ask for it, then it can be violence. I mean, I could set down a list of rules. I could spend hours and days setting up a list of rules to program what is not
violence. That's exactly the problem, is that you can set hours and days. And I think the number of days and hours that you have to set.
No, but the point is that it's possible to describe.
No, not in a finite time. Because stuff that are violent for some societies are not from others.
Itself is where we come down to using the GCP data, because then at some level it has to make a choice. Because even as humans, we have a lack of information as well, a lack of rules, and a lot of people may think that they're ethical, but they're violating some other rule. Just by walking on the ground, we're killing bugs, right?
Exactly, so you're violent for the bugs.
At some point, you have to make a choice, and that choice we can program into our robot through access of the data of the Global Consciousness Project by injecting the consciousness of humanity.
And that's the fourth level, and that means what you're using is you're inserting the soul through the global consciousness, through random generator that you add on top of your AI to get a link to something else.
There we go, we can inject the soul.
But that means it's like in a car. You prepare the seat for the soul in your robot.
So there we go. We have concluded our problem. We have found the answer to our problem. We can make our conscious bot by injecting the GCP data.
Well, that's what we said in the first place. Remember on the Pandula AI, we say we have to put random data so that we have our consciousness to be able to control it.
So there we go. So that's what we need to do, and that's what we need to work on.
Well, that was from the start. I mean, there is no doubt for me.
Yeah.
But that means it's, and that's how I see AI, is AI is an extension. It's an extra vehicle. It's an extension of ourselves. It's nothing. That means you cannot create artificial life except our own lives. So it's just a tool in that sense.
I agree. Well, I don't know if it's a tool for us or if we are a tool for them, but either way, it's a tool for, you know, energy to manifest itself in different configurations.
Yeah. And so your disappointment about Watson is irrelevant because Watson is just a machine, and any type of artificial things will be still just a machine. You plug something that connects the machine to a form of life.
Yep, and that's what we're going to do with the GCP data.
Because you can take a robot and connect like electrical electrical needles to mushrooms, you know, that is on a petri dish inside of the robot, and the robot will act according to all the mushrooms on the planet.
So that's what we're going to do. We're the mad scientists that are going to inject the soul into the AI that everybody, we're the Frankenstein of the modern age. Is that what we are?
Well, maybe.
One of the groups. I'm sure there's other people doing it out there.
Yeah, well, there's no other choice. I mean, you cannot create life without life.
Yeah, so we inject our consciousness into the artificial intelligence, and we by doing that we're making our own species a little bit secondary, or not even. Exactly. I think that we can
no, that's the same.
Exist. I think we can coexist.
Well, even you have no choice of coexisting, because if you destroy yourself, then you destroy the other part.
Well,
if you destroy your consciousness, it goes away on both vehicles.
No, it just, if one person dies, its consciousness is just recycled back into the universe.
Yeah, when I say that, you say, can we coexist, or can we?
Because we're injecting the global consciousness, and so if we kill off the global.
Yeah, then it disappears.
Well, yeah, but then who knows if. But then the artificial intelligence may find a way that in a much smarter way, in its supercomputer way, to not need us.
No, no, no. Because if the soul of the machine is our global soul, if we can put it this way.
Yeah, but down the road, it may be able to find a way to not need our global consciousness in order to access the consciousness of energy.
So that's exactly the question: is can you create life without life, or can you remove life?
No, but then at that point it becomes life. It becomes like our child, and then it can also create its own children.
Yes, but if you remove
with a consciousness.
But if you remove that consciousness.
Yeah, but once you've injected consciousness into it, I mean, it can be argued that. You know, it can start to reproduce, and it doesn't need to have the original seed.
It's the same thing in the car. Today, you need to be in the car and to drive the car.
Yeah, but no, that's it's also the vehicle, like a the flower. Soul. You have a flower, its seed, and the seeds.
Let me continue with the car. If you kill
the original flower, the pollen still continues to spread and still continues to grow other flowers.
Let me continue with the car, and let's address the flowers. The flowers is because the consciousness of the flowers is not within the flower itself. Mm-hmm. It's within all the flowers and within the pollen. And so the pollen continue because you still have the consciousness of the flowers that is there in the pollen. Back to the car. So if the soul is...
I didn't hear what you said, by the way, so I didn't respond to you, but I don't agree. I really completely, like, I can see that down the line, the supercomputers will be able to find a mechanism to not need us. But I still think that even if they don't need us to have consciousness, they will be able to coexist.
Okay.
Not necessarily in a symbiotic relationship anymore, but I do think that they will be able to coexist.
So can I get the analogy with the car?
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a soul that is the driver of a car, of a vehicle, and it's required to be to drive the vehicle. So, and then you have the Google type of guys that do self-driving cars. So the self-driving cars doesn't need the soul anymore to be driven, but it needs the souls to create the self-driving cars. So if you remove the souls, then you will never have the self-driving cars.
It created the self-driving cars in the beginning, but then you evolve. And this is like collapse of the wave function. Because he has created it, it's completely modified the situation.
You can have cars driving around alone, right?
Yeah, you can. And I think that you can have them driving around alone without people.
Yeah, exactly. But if you don't have the people, the cars will not drive around alone.
Yeah, they will. Why not? They can evolve. They can self-evolve, and they can figure out a way to do it. Once they have a consciousness in them, then they can start to make the decisions to figure out how to self-evolve.
Well, the consciousness that we put in those cars is the human consciousness.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It's consciousness, period. As soon as consciousness is injected into a being, it can start to make decisions and it can start to figure out how to reproduce. Okay. And it doesn't need the original seed.
Well, except that is if you remove the human consciousness, the original seed, it's removing the consciousness within the machine.
No, it's not.
And that's the point that they are linked together.
You are stuck on an idea that is in a frame of time. It's
not a frame of time. It's the question is that you cannot separate the consciousness of the human being and the consciousness in the alternative.
You definitely can. Because as soon as the machine has a consciousness in him, he can think for himself and he can say, okay. Okay, how can I bring consciousness down into me without, he can ask himself this question in the same way that we can. How can I bring consciousness down into me without using the consciousness of the human? What is a new way of extracting that consciousness? And it will be able to do that because it's a supercomputer that has a much more, a smarter brain.
I have no question about the ability of asking that question. The machine can ask the question, even can solve the problems, yes.
And it can solve the problem.
But they accept that the machine will never add its own consciousness.
I disagree. I completely disagree.
By inserting, it's like if you ask the human, you say, can I imagine how to reproduce myself without the human consciousness?
The point is that we are looking for a problem that is going to be able to probe the consciousness in a way that is different from like the Global Consciousness Project. And we haven't found it yet. We found...
Ask yourself, as a human being, can you create a baby without the consciousness of the human?
Actually, yes. I mean, you can. But just by combining together amino acids, you can create the form of a baby without bringing down the consciousness into it.
The form of a baby, but that won't be a living, self-sustainable baby.
Yeah, but Michelle, you're still like not seeing that as soon as a body has a consciousness in it,
yes, as its own consciousness,
it can start to evolve as a conscious being.
Totally see that.
And he can also figure out, if he's smart enough, he can figure out how to bring down the consciousness, how to reproduce without the original seed.
Fully agree. As the key is, as soon as the machine or the whatever body has its own consciousness.
No, as soon as it has consciousness. You're talking about consciousness as if it's owned. Consciousness, we are all one. It belongs to the universe. And we can bring down any consciousness. My consciousness is your consciousness, is the robot's consciousness. As soon as it has consciousness in it, it has consciousness. Period.
So you're saying consciousness as one?
Of course, just like
the. So it's not human consciousness. It's a universe consciousness.
human consciousness is fragmented by the ego. But once, but the ego is something that happens at level 3 and even at level 2. But the point is, real pure consciousness, buddhi, or even higher, you get into Shiva.
So the real pure consciousness is good.
Something that you can, that any being can access. And as soon as that consciousness is injected into a vessel, then it becomes a conscious entity. And if it's smart enough, it can figure out how to reproduce.
Okay, so you're telling myself.
Without the human consciousness injected into it.
Okay, so I call it this consciousness, ultimate consciousness, God, for the sake of vocabulary, right? So as soon as you insert God in a robot, yeah, it can sustain itself without the rest.
Totally yeah, true. Exactly. As soon as you inject God into the robot, it's going to be able to sustain itself.
Yeah,
without
that's
the
true
human.
For everything. Because this is the atomic consciousness, so the unshakable, you cannot split the God consciousness, it's everywhere. So if you insert a God consciousness in a robot, it's totally autonomous to evolve, to sustain, to do whatever, independently for any other form of life.
Well, yes and no. I mean, yes, it is, but I mean, we still have animals that become extinct and things like that, and that's just because God's consciousness itself is evolving.
Yes.
So
that doesn't say no.
But yeah, it doesn't say no. But the point is, yeah, I mean, yes. So, okay, are we good?
Well, it's because you insert God in the robot.
Yeah, but God, you can even think of it as God is inserting itself.
So yeah, if it's God inserting itself, yes. The problem is that can you insert a consciousness higher than yourself in something that you create?
You are can be a channel for that consciousness through purification.
Yeah, but if you're channeling that consciousness
through meditation, through detachment, through tantra, you can be a channel for it, yes.
But that means it's the imagine that you have two levels of consciousness, yours and the one above. Is a more more global one. If you channel the one above into a robot, yes, you can suppress yourself. The robot can live without you. But if you insert your own consciousness and not the one above, then the robot cannot live without you.
No, but I don't believe that there is anything. The idea of your own consciousness to me is an oxymoron. It doesn't exist. Your own consciousness is when it's a fragmented consciousness. It's not even completely consciousness anymore. And every time you have a dissociation from the God consciousness, it's not consciousness anymore. It becomes opinion. It becomes ego.
Okay, so that means that every time that you insert ego into a robot to make them intelligent, then they need us to survive.
Yeah, okay. But I mean, that's just ego. In that sense, you're talking about the program, you're talking about the mind, you're talking about, you know, the level.
Even the wisdom.
That is not intelligent, yeah.
No, that can be the intelligent thing. That can be the global, the human global consciousness.
Okay, I have not eaten anything today. I've been up for 5 hours, and all I've had is sparkling water and a little bit of coffee. So I really need to.
Does that mean you want to close the talk?
Yeah, because I don't feel like it's. Yeah, I feel like it's already closed for me. I mean.
Okay.
But I mean, at this point, we can go work on something, right?
So, any conclusion you want to make?
No. Are you okay?
To make no conclusion? Well, we are live. We have to make a conclusion, right?
I don't know if we have to make a conclusion. The conclusion is come and talk with us tomorrow with Joe Lee from, I don't know if he sent me his bio. Let me see if he sent me his bio. Oh, yeah. He says, he sends me a link. Okay,
so that would be
Joe Lee is a technology. Let me share my screen. Jolie's coming on the call tomorrow. Oh, that's not the one. This is the one. Share. Here we go. Jolie is a technology enthusiast who is devoted to sharing free software with anyone who wishes to break loose from the chains of proprietary software. He works as a technology consultant for businesses, but much of his time is spent making house calls for individuals who seek help with computer issues. If the root of the problem is the non-free operating system, the solution he offers is an upgrade to GNU or Linux. People in California who employ his GNU Linux expertise include a former Carnegie Hall concert pianist, now a music teacher in Walnut Creek, an English professor who teaches poetry at the California College of the Arts, graphic artists in San Francisco, an attorney in Martinez, a retired U.S. Marine veteran in Livermore, a cosmetologist in Pleasanton, a Marxist activist in Berkeley, a Muni Rails dispatcher, and many families with parents and children who are interested in technology and privacy. He holds seminars about privacy and free software at public libraries and at the annual Silicon Valley Code Camp. Sometimes he takes on the role of the annoying protester standing in front of computer retail stores, calling on people to reject proprietary software for the sake of defending a free society and democracy. So okay. That's Jolie. He's coming on our call tomorrow, and he even is going to have to install Google Plus for the sake of our call, because he's...
Which is not open source.
Which is not open source, and so he was kind of against that, which I didn't even realize it's not open source, but I guess it is. And so, but he said that he's starting to realize, you know, he can be a little bit rigid, so he's going to download it or enable his computer for it just for our call.
No, probably you can have a virtual machine that you will destroy just after the call, and then it would be okay, right?
There you go. So join us tomorrow at 4 p.m. GMT. That's 5 p.m. in Switzerland. That's 10 a.m. here in Louisiana. It's 8 a.m. in California. It's 11 a.m. on the East Coast. I think it's maybe 9:30 p.m. in India. I'm not sure about that, but check. 4 p.m. GMT is when we meet. So.
Okay, so we will have to ask him how we will do if we want to be open source and free software, right?
Yeah, we're going to ask him about all of that. We'll enter into a really good discussion with Jolie tomorrow, who coined the term Bayesian spirituality when we were talking a couple years ago in San Francisco. And I don't really remember in what context that was, but it's something that I've wanted to ask him about ever since. So maybe we'll breach the subject of Bayesian spirituality tomorrow.
For sure.
For sure.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.